juggle around the agenda a bit. The first item we are not addressing tonight, there will be no public hearing. I don't see the Casses or Dan Weber, so we can move into the discussion of the Class 6 road.
All right, well.
Moving right along.
All right then, so what you have before your guidelines that the select board would like the input from the planning board, we're also asking the Conservation Commission for their input. The only policy that the town of Rollinsford has regarding Class 6 roads is in the zoning blue book. It just says we don't allow it. There have been a number of waivers granted over the years by the planning board in conjunction with the select board, I guess. They were going to issue the building permits. What we have found is that other towns have guidelines on how to deal with it. We don't. We look to our neighbors to the north. The town of New Durham has a set, which you see before you, but it was just substituted the name Rollinsford for New Durham. And we'd like your guidance.
Okay.
We understand that folks may not be enthralled with building on Class 6 roads. We may not be either in some cases, but we have no standard policy of how to deal with this. So if we find ourselves in a quandary at times, it's difficult to give people an answer when they see that it's happened in other places in town.
Yep. Do you know the waivers that have been issued, where those are?
There have been waivers on Old Indigo Hill Road, which is going to be Greenview Drive. There was, by town meeting, authorization on Scotland Road, and I'm forgetting the third one.
Okay.
But it has happened in the town in the past, so.
Yep.
Through a different mechanism. Like, I know the one on, like I said, on Scotland Road would be a town meeting authorization. The one on Al Evergreen was done with planning board.
Old Indigo Hill Road is called Evergreen?
It is now Evergreen.
Oh.
It will be called Evergreen at the town. The town adopts it. They come to town meeting. It's where the oil recycling.
Okay. I thought it was called Greenview.
Greenview. I'm taking it backwards. Apparently I've become dyslexic this evening. I apologize. Greenview.
No,
Evergreen.
Do you have another copy of this?
I do.
Once we're talking about
Class 6 road policy.
Oh, okay.
And it's like we're really just looking for the guidance,
okay,
and advice of the planning board.
Well, I'll open it up for discussion among the panel
members.
Yes,
notes.
So if this were adopted, it would not have to go to town meeting?
No, because there are only guidelines that the select board may or may not follow.
Okay.
Relative to the issuance of a building permit on a special class of road.
Yep.
Is my understanding. I believe that the New Durham guidelines were born out of the Vashon New Durham Supreme Court case.
Oh.
Where there was a resident by the name of Vashon, or someone who owned property by the name of Vashon in the town of New Durham and wanted to build on Class 6 road, and was denied and went back and forth. John probably is more intimately knowledgeable of this than I am. He was in that part of the world. But that this was born out of that process also. They didn't have, actually, these guidelines that we were told were adopted mid-process, actually, and the Supreme Court actually accepted them and denied the Vashon their building permit.
Well, because
we're not looking to do that. I don't want anyone to think.
Yeah.
We just want it to come up, and we haven't had a good answer for.
It's a perennial issue.
A year. Going on a year. So
just to follow on what Mike said,
there's, if you look across the state, and I have not done a scientific or a formal survey, but I would say that probably about a third of the communities in the state or more have no policies. So they just sort of deal with it on when an issue arises. Probably a third of the communities or thereabouts have some sort of policy about how to deal with it. And then probably a third or so of the communities in the state specifically prohibit development on class 6 roads. So Mike had sent me this for review of the select board head. I looked at it and made some comments. And that's one of the things I said, you know, is that, and I'm not suggesting that's the right approach, but, you know, the select board or you know, the planning board or all the land use boards could say, or could recommend, you know, that may be an approach, just you don't develop class 6 roads.
Mm-hmm.
It's, Hanover's a classic case. They have a ton of class 6 roads. You know, they value them for recreation purposes, and they don't want to give those up. So, you know, your class 6 roads are a little bit different. I don't know if they're used recreationally or for hikers or walkers, but you got to remember that if they are, and someone wants to develop them or put a turn them in their driveway, that sort of amenity goes away for the whole community. But I think if you're going to allow building on class 6 roads, you know, a policy like this is certainly a reasonable thing to do.
Yep.
The one thing I wanted to sort of draw you all a diagram, and it doesn't address this in here, but for those of you who have been on the planning board, we lay out a road, and we require a 50-foot wide right-of-way, and that the fee in that right-of-way is ultimately owned by the town. Generally, it starts with the developer, and when the town takes over the road, that right-of-way becomes the town's land. Typically a class 6 road, I'm going to do this, here's a class 6 road. Typically a class 6 road is owned to the middle by each landowner on either side. So the landowner owns the center of the thread of the road on either side. There's typically not a right-of-way. And one of the things that I just noticed here is that, you know, it may behoove the select board to say, we want a right-of-way. Now, it may not be practical in all cases, because if you try to draw something here, landowner A, here's a class 6 road running through here. Let's say this landowner here wants to build on this piece of property, mm-hmm. and then landowner B is over here. They're not a party to it. I suppose the only thing that they could do is this person here could maybe lay out, you know, 25 feet of right away, because they wouldn't, if they only owned the center of that road, they wouldn't be able to lay out all 50 feet. But so I think if there could be an actual right away that the town would have ownership of in the event that was developed, I think it would make sense. I don't know how to do it mechanically, but it becomes a problem when you have a road laid out with no formal right away.
So how would that work from, if I don't take one of the drawings here. So this lot gets developed.
Yeah.
This guy has no interest in developing.
I don't know. That's a good question.
He's going to give up a right of way?
I know. Well, that's the question that let's just draw something more simple. So here's this classic road running through here. Property owner A, property owner B. This person wants to develop it. I would almost say that maybe they just give up 30 feet along the road, and then, or I'm sorry, 25 feet. And,
yep.
and such times this person wants to, maybe they do something like that. But I don't. You can't, because this guy wants to do something. You can't force this person
right,
to get out land.
So even though it's a road that's gone out of use, the town still takes ownership of the road.
You don't
have any right of way on
the road. Generally, you don't have a right of way. Especially if the road was ever subject to gates and bars, then the road, you still have the right to use the road, but generally the ownership of the abutting parcels goes to the center of the road.
Okay.
So, and if that's, you know, there may be class 6 roads where there is an old right-of-way,
yeah.
But my point is that if there is not a right-of-way, every effort, I think, should be made to provide that right-of-way.
There are a list of conditions that would be placed on on an applicant for purposes of building on a class six road, so that could become one of them.
That's right, yeah, and I think if you look at, you know, somewhere in section six probably, that, you know, maybe every effort should be made to provide a right of way consistent with the town roads regulations.
Oh, it is here.
What?
6D.
You know, I don't know how to do that.
It is, but it doesn't spec.
Yes, it does. I guess it doesn't.
Three.
Yeah, you're right.
D3.
I missed it.
Require the applicant to provide a deed or easement to secure a full 50-foot right of way for the class six road or something less than 50-foot.
Well, there you go, I guess we're covered. I don't know how to do that in a case where, you know, but I guess that's someone's problem, you know.
So would they just put the whole 50 feet on one?
I guess, and the road is outside of the right of way, which is a little bit peculiar, but it does happen. So I guess that's something.
So the other item that pops out here, and I think we'd like your guidance, or we'd like your guidance on all, where it goes. Number five, the waiver of distance of limitations. The select board may consider waiving the 600-foot limitations of section four, pardon me, section four, go back to section four. Distance to class five road. If the guideline of the select board that in the unusual case, no building permit will be authorized if the driveway access to the principal structure from class six road begins more than 600 feet from the intersection of a class six road and a class five road or better. And this is just an arbitrary number, I think, that Durham chose. I don't know how they came up with it, why they came up with it, but.
The whole paragraph doesn't read right, does it?
It's a little kludgy.
Here's the guideline of the select board that in the unusual case. In the usual case. We have a maximum length of a driveway too. So I think what this is saying is if the class six road was say 550 feet and the driveway was another 550 feet, that would be okay, right?
Right. So so
now we're talking 1,000 feet to a house.
Well, that's just it. So take Scotland Road to Front Street. We would if these guidelines had been in place when that issue came up, the select board, they could waive it, they could issue a building permit if the driveway is going to be more than 600 feet from front to the parcel that they want to build on. So the idea is that we don't want emergency vehicles having to go in, where they're going to get stuck potentially with damage, trying to go in and put a fire or do a police issue, whatever it is. This 500 or 600 feet, I mean, I don't know if there's a, there is a magic number. I don't know why the Durham chose, like I said, 600. I have no idea.
So is this new Durham's like word for word?
It is, yes.
And,
changed it, Rollins version.
And has the town council had a chance to look at this?
Yes, he's the one who forwarded that to us.
Okay, and so he likes it?
Yes.
Okay.
He likes the, let me back up. He likes the concept of having guidelines in place. They don't necessarily have to. These are favorable only that because that the Supreme Court looks favorably upon them in the Vashon and Durham case. But that's where he's coming from. Doesn't have to be identical to this. But.
And so if the select board adopts a policy, what are the ability to the select board to change the policy? What has to, can they do it when, or does it, once it adopts a policy, do you have to
go to town meeting?
No,
these are just guidelines to guide the board in dealing with whether or not we would want to issue a building permit on a class six road.
Mm-hmm.
Just to guide us, but we have no guidelines at the moment. We're not binding another board to them. They can reject them if they want to. They're not.
Now, if the town.
I understand.
Okay. John was saying that some towns have a policy of not allowing any building on Class 6.
We have that very clear in our zoning ordinance, it says we don't allow building on Class 6 roads.
And so.
But we've granted waivers in the past, and that's, people still keep coming forward and want to build, so.
And so it's a question of.
You all, the planning board can still say no. I mean, don't get me wrong, just because we have guidelines in place, doesn't mean we expect you to.
Well, we can say no, in the situation that, let's just say, landowner B comes to the select board saying, it's already there. Sits back 300 feet off of a class, off of a town road, it's been a lot of record forever, all they want is a building permit, we wouldn't see them. So they would just come to you for a building permit.
Right.
And then we would not, we, in that case, we'd never see, there wouldn't be a planning board.
Say that again, though?
This lot already, this is a town road.
Right.
This lot exists today.
Okay.
It's, let's say it's 300 feet back.
Right, but it's still on a Class 6 road.
This is a Class 6 road, they just come and get a bastard building.
But they don't have frontage on a Class 5 road that's required.
But that'd be zoning, it wouldn't be this board. They'd get a variance, but they, you know, the lot exists today.
Okay, I see what you mean.
We would see, now, if someone wanted to subdivide, you know, that.
Okay.
Then we'd see them.
Okay.
So there's a lot, there's many cases where this board wouldn't see.
Okay. Then the zoning.
It would be either the zoning board or the board, or, and, you know, or the board's like.
Okay.
And so you're saying, follow up on John's point, so if you had this, if you done this policy, and then you approved of one, it still has to go in front of the ZBA?
Well, in the case that, well, we would have to go to the ZBA first, right, to get a variance before they could build?
I would say, because they don't have frontage.
Because they don't have frontage. In this area, yeah.
It's a tough, the state says you have to have frontage on a Class 5 highway or better to get a building. So if you don't have frontage on a Class 5 highway or better, one would assume you get a variance. Sometimes selectmen issue those building permits regularly without going through a variance process. I'm not familiar with what Rollinsford has done in the past. You know, the other thing that this, I don't think this addresses it, is what happens, I think this is targeted towards someone building a home, but what happens when landowner B has 40 acres back there and they want to do a subdivision? That to me is a different, you know, it's one thing to vary or to allow someone to upgrade a Class 6 road to use for driveway use. But if we're going to use it, it's going to be used for, say, 30 lots, or Greenview Technologies is a classic, as a better example, I guess, or an industrial use, then really the upgrade should be to Class 5 standard.
Right.
Which is what Greenview has done.
Right.
I think.
They did, yeah.
Accepting.
But the way that we have.
Accepting underground utilities, I believe, right?
Yeah.
But that's it, but the road itself was the town standard. So perhaps, you know, it might make sense to add a section here saying, and I don't know what the limit is, if it's, is it two homes, is it three homes? But at some point, the threshold is met where the road should be upgraded to Class 5.
Right.
Standard. And I guess you've got to be able to decide what the trigger is. Maybe it's daily trips, so you deal with commercial and resident, you know. If it was more than 15 trips a day.
Yeah.
Then you would snag the second house.
Think of the additional Class 6 roads that are left in town, where they would.
Right, so there's the road that goes from there over to.
Right.
Fresh Creek Street, yeah, or.
Fresh Creek.
That's called Fresh Creek. How many different lots does this affect in town?
Well, that's what I'm trying to figure out, so there's Shady Lane, there's Fresh Creek, and. The other end of Old Eagle Road, it's all hills. I think we're out to grab a Class 6 road if I'm going to.
Is it more land in Scout Land or not?
No, it's all in conservation.
Okay. So.
Really, I'm just talking to your roads.
There's one off of Old Mill, isn't there?
Yeah, that's Fresh Creek.
Fresh Creek, oh, yeah.
But it also comes off to Bear, too, between Bear and Oak Street.
Yeah.
And Old Mill.
Is that right at the end of Sligo?
Yeah, if you kept going straight.
Yeah.
Then you can drive down.
Park down.
And
so I'm wondering if the situation that John just brought up could happen. Given the 600 feet, you could be talking about 4-6 houses tops, maybe.
Yeah.
So.
Yep.
But if we were talking about reopening, or turning road like Shale Lane into a Class 5 road back up to Dover, that's what you would need to have to do a subdivision.
Then it's available. Then you want a Class 5 road.
Yeah.
I mean, that's correct. Right. You know. I just don't know what the threshold is. Is it two houses? Is it three houses? I don't know.
I think that's worth addressing. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mike, if I could ask a question about 6D, and I'm thinking back to what Pat was saying, ask a question about maintenance on cell phones.
Six what?
6D and David.
D and David?
Right.
Okay, yeah.
And I remember when Pat was on the board asked a question about the maintenance of cell phone towers and so forth, and he said, you know, enforcement is always difficult. How would the town go about enforcing a road maintenance rule?
It would have to be recorded at the registry.
Mm-hmm.
I would assume, which is always a bad thing to do, I guess,
that
our only recourse would be legal action.
Right.
Against the landlord.
And to force
them to maintain the road. Or they won't receive services like police or fire or any other municipal services like that.
I mean, Judy's in the room. She's a party to one of those agreements, so we get it. Oh. I can't remember how that worked.
Yeah, it's filed with the deed. First of all, to know that anything was wrong, I assume we're going to count on our neighbors, like we do for so many other enforcements here in town.
So either of the parties that live, any parties that agreement would notify the soil?
That's what I'm assuming would happen.
Yeah.
Right now, it's a nice, comfortable group of people. We all get along wonderfully. The road's being better maintained than it ever has been before, so it's working out really, really well. Should that change, you can bet that I might be in here at the select board meeting in a heartbeat saying that he's not keeping up the road, we're not even speaking to each other anymore, whatever it is. And then, so to know about it, it would be, I'm assuming the parties on the road would let the select board know, and it would go from there. That's my assumption.
Well, the road agent, though, could also, when we get another road agent, would be able to observe, I mean, because still a Class 6 or still a town road, it would go down the road. And we have sent our former road agent down a few times down Fresh Creek to retrieve tires and couches.
And one other comment, I do believe when the road was upgraded to put the two lots on it for sale, which have both been sold, that there was built-in review.
There was.
Perhaps annual review or whatever. I don't know if it was annual, but it went on for a couple of years, a year anyway. But I know, so there's something built into the agreement.
That Judy's case wasn't a Class 6, but it was.
Right.
I think the road maintenance agreement was about the same issue would arise.
Yeah. Yeah. So what about like plowing and stuff?
The town has no liability. Yeah, but it's part of the agreement that it would be maintained that way, where you wouldn't be able to receive services.
And if you read the statement of purpose under Section 2, this is the sort of caveat that everybody has to, you know, understand. That even though development on a Class 6 road is meant to be private for perpetuity, they can certainly submit a petition to have the town accept the road, and nothing. You can't stop someone from trying to do that. You know, selectmen can beat their chest and say, "Hey, listen, that wasn't part of the agreement. Don't vote for this." But
in raid,
they have the right to petition the town.
They have the right to petition the town now, right?
Absolutely. So. Yeah, right.
Hmm.
And there's nothing in this agreement includes that. You would hope that they would not do it, but.
I guess my last question, Mike, is there an urgency to, if you guys are set to adopt this on the 18th, is it?
We're having a public hearing.
Oh, okay.
That's
all right, okay.
We're taking public comment. This is what we want, the advice of the planning board. And we were reaching out to the Conservation Commission also.
It just,
a number of these properties, but it's just what John brought up. Will this impact the overall use and enjoyment by other residents. More Scoutland Road, but that really shouldn't be an issue. There was almost, even that lot that was built on wouldn't qualify under these guidelines, but.
If you attempt to walk down Shady Lane, it disappears within a few hundred feet of going down.
It turns down to the left through some.
Yeah.
Overgrown.
It's very briar and overgrown. I mean, if you get through that, the rest of the road is there, but there's a berm of. You have to go out in the field and then cut, like, across to whoever's lawn. So I did used to live very close to there.
I went out once and yes, someone came out yelling, saying that was on the property. Didn't mean to, sorry.
Okay, any other comments?
These are helpful, I'll take these back, and if, again, if you have more thoughts, just shoot me an email, I'll be happy to pass them on to the board. I don't pretend that these are perfect. They seem to work for New Durham, but it doesn't mean they would work for us, so they're just a good starting point. Again, because we don't have any policy, so people will come, to us and say, can we do this? And say, well, you gotta go talk to zoning or planning.
Right.
But as of now, no. But if they say yes, well, we have no, nothing to guide us, so. We could still say no also, actually, if we want to. Futile, one of the other chips said yes. They,
okay.
Thanks.
Don't see the passes or Mr. Weber. Judy, do you want to, taking things kind of out of order here, but in the interest of your time, do you want to approach the board?
Sure, I appreciate that.
Air your grievances?
Actually, no grievances whatsoever, and my first call is going to be somewhat timely. John actually referenced it. So a couple things I want to just mention. One is a quick story about that happened, started during my time on the planning board, and is now taking place. So things can take some time to happen. And the other one is about Stratford Regional Planning Commission, of which I am a representative of the town at the moment. So the first one is a story. So across from Alexander's Restaurant, there was a parcel that was subdivided. This board heard the subdivision, saw the subdivision plan, approved it. It cut two lots. It was the Morbridge property.
Oh, yeah.
And
It first obtained a variance.
Yes, because there wasn't enough frontage. That is correct.
Got it.
So, at my time on the board, and some of you were on the board at the time, John was here anyway. And as the board often did, it granted a variance to underground utilities, which are part of our subdivision regs.
Against my recommendation.
Against John's recommendation. Now, I had been listening to John carefully in the previous couple of years, and this was the place where I took my stand. And I said, I am voting against that. I'm voting against the variance because we want underground utilities for a number of reasons. Lots of reasons, and every time an ice storm comes in, that's one of them, as well as aesthetics, of course. So recently, they started developing the property. It's been a number of years since this happened. And the argument at the time, I remember it distinctly, was no big deal, one pole for one pole. One pole already exists, we're going to replace it with one pole. So my final statement on that is, it was not replaced with one pole, it was replaced with three poles that now march into the property. So, and I drive by it every day, or every time I drive out, so I'm just here to say, if we have something in our regulations, we should think hard before we waive them. Or if the board is always going to waive them, get them out. I mean, so that we're not always doing waivers. Anyway, that's just my little story. And John actually mentioned it about
the gun. This is Judy's time, but I did want to follow up real quickly, only because this is a tough waiver. People come to us all the time and saying, it's expensive. It's only one pole. It's only two poles. No one's going to see it. And my pitch to the board has always been, everybody that drives down Route 4 or everybody that drives down every other road is going to see those forever. And You know, yes, it's expensive, but it was expensive to buy the property, it's expensive to build the house, so why should the public suffer because that last little thing you didn't want to pay for? So I'm sure there are cases where granting waivers to the underground utility requirement makes sense, but I do think the board tends to waive that maybe, you know, more than they should. And I agree with you, if we're going to waive it time and time again, maybe it's, you know, we should, you know, just get rid of it.
And I'll add to that, some of you know that Suzanne and I live way out in the back, and telephone poles come in along the shared driveway. But our utilities are underground, and we love it. Nobody sees it. It can't be seen from the road. But first of all, we don't have to worry about ice storms. We don't have to worry about any of that. We don't have to worry about people, PS&H coming in and Eversource, whatever they are now. You know, keeping the lines clear and all that stuff. It is absolutely fabulous in terms of maintenance, and it's just a wonderful thing. So, all right, and so we'll move on from that. But thank you for hearing me out. So I have been the town has two representatives to Stratford Regional Planning Commission. They are, as the name says, a regional planning commission. They do cover more than Stratford County. I wasn't sure of everything they did, and I still sometimes think I don't know. I've been going now for a number of years. But they really assist in planning, all different types of planning. Infrastructure, transportation planning, culverts, bridges, roads. I mean, they've helped the town do 10-year plans. They've helped the town do emergency plans. One of the things that happened most recently that I think we'll all appreciate is that at one of those meetings, I heard about the DES, the Department of Environmental something, okay, had grants for replacing diesel engines that were going to be replaced. We were about to look at replacing a fire truck at the tune of over $400,000. I let Suzanne, who is the other representative from the select board, know. She showed up at the next meeting and started talking to this person, and the town is now receiving over $100,000 toward our new fire truck, so over a quarter of the cost. So just by that chance, doing it. I mean, so they help with grants. I mean, they really help with a lot of different stuff. So it's been great. I really enjoyed my time. I was named to it by the select board a number of years ago because I was on the planning board. It really makes sense to have someone from the planning board go if be the person if possible. I'm just here giving that pitch because I will be leaving. I will be tendering my whatever it is, resignation to the select board or whatever sometime in the next 6 months or so. So I just wanted to give people time to think about that.
What's the time commitment?
Yeah, so there's a monthly meeting. And they are in the morning, Friday mornings. I was also on the executive committee, so my morning was much longer. But there are mornings at 9 o'clock. They go for an hour and a half.
In Rochester.
It's in Rochester. Well, most of the time it's in Rochester. Yep. And then every quarter there's a quarterly meeting. It's in the afternoon. So that's the...
So 16 meetings a year, about.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. And certainly no more. And you don't have to go to every one. That's... There are minutes, there are notes, and everything. They get a lot of the stuff out to you to review.
Coffee and donuts.
Coffee. Sometimes there's food.
$800,000 a year.
Yeah.
Courthouse coffee.
I mean, really, $100,000 made up for the dues that we pay. Because we're a small town, the dues are based on population in the town. So we don't pay a ton in dues. But as a member, we get discounted services from them if we purchase some of their services. So
okay.
Take a look at the site on the SRPC, Stratford Regional.
Stratford Regional Planning. Dot org.
Right. It's SRPC.org. And it's just a ton of maps. I mean, they've got all the big mapping stuff, and they'll put out all the maps you need of your town and the roads. And it's amazing.
So we have a little time to kind of cough up a little.
Yeah, so think about it. you'll hear probably more pleas from the select board at that point, once I say, you know, we need another person.
Anyway, thank you for your time, Mr.
Thank you very much.
And listening to you talking tonight, I mean, I miss it.
You miss it?
I do. You guys are doing a good job. Thank you very much.
Opening for an alternate. Thank you so much.
Good to see you all.
Nice to see you.
Okay. So we still don't see any passes or whoever's. So why don't we move on to approval of the minutes? Tree removal. So I went to the transfer station on Saturday and I think those trees are gone. I don't know if anyone else noticed. If they're the ones that I think they are, right along the roadway, under the power line.
They were cutting trees along there. They said they were going to hold off on the Clearwater property trees. This was Eversource asked them, wants to trim them. Because this planning board, I wasn't on the board then, but the planning board required Clearwater to plant these as a buffer, a screen. And Eversource wants to either cut them down entirely or trim them way back. So
I read one of the notes from Caroline that Clearwater doesn't care about the trees. They just want to make sure that they're not going to run into issues with the planning board.
Right.
And I think that if they need to be cut, then I don't, you know.
Well, if they work that way.
Well, if they work, I guess it's a good point.
They can try to glue
them. Still, it's not, Clearwater isn't approaching us because they want them. It's because Eversource is asking them to do it.
Would we require them to plant new trees?
I don't think you could, but I think the lesson to be learned is that when we're looking at site plans, and we look at very few of them, that if we do require trees to be planted, we probably should. I wasn't on the board at the time, I wasn't involved with the board at the time, but we should require that they plant trees far enough away from utility lines.
Or height appropriate, you know, bushes.
Right. So this doesn't happen again, but I think if they were gone, it's water over the dam. I don't think it would be fair to ask them to replant.
I agree.
So should we give them approval, even if Asplund already has them, so they don't feel like they're doing anything wrong?
It might be good. Yeah.
I think that's prudent. Does anyone else have any thoughts? And Glenn, you are appointed a voting member, since it seems like we're going to have a vote. I would entertain a motion to approve the tree removal.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
I'm going to say I'm opposed just because I haven't looked at it, but the ayes will carry.
Okay.
Maybe. Oh,
except
I.
Oh.
We're
going to
tie.
The ayes have it.
Trees have probably already cut down.
All right. So why don't we jump back up to the minutes? Sarah sent those out earlier. I don't know if anyone's had a chance to review. Okay. Is there a motion to accept the minutes?
To accept the minutes of August, March, September. Yeah.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. Minutes are accepted. I did not see any correspondence, but there's a huge whiteboard or something on the table where the mail usually would be in that room.
Yeah, we got one too at the library. It's pretty small.
Okay.
Oh, a smart board?
Yeah.
Yes. They apparently replaced them. I don't know. We've taken possession of one.
So I didn't see any correspondence.
It's been there for, I think, a couple weeks.
Okay, so the mail will be on top. Somewhere else. Okay, so no correspondence. I'm not sure where the rest of the folks are, but I'm sure we can hear from them next month.
I know Caroline reached out to me because she reached out to us to see if there was still time to get them on the agenda, so.
Okay.
Is there any update on Bullen?
What? The Bullen Mill?
No. Lavoie.
Believe that he's waiting to come back in October.
To this board or to the select?
To this board, I think.
Where does it stand, Sarah? Did we deny it?
No, you.
They didn't have a valid application.
Yeah.
Well, they resubmitted an application and we asked them to hold it until this was.
But we've never continued it, so it's gotta be renoticed for where they show up.
They have to submit a whole new application.
Okay, I couldn't remember what happened, so I just wanted to make sure.
They haven't fully submitted.
I just wanted to show up in October saying, we're here, and.
Yeah.
No, they understand they have to submit an application, so.
Okay.
I think they wanted to know if we were actually gonna, the board, whether or not that project moves forward or doesn't move forward and wants to have some sort of guidelines in place.
Yeah.
In case another one comes up.
Yeah.
We were in a better situation, I think, I don't want to speak for them, but I believe they're waiting to see if what happens with these guidelines, but I think they're coming back either way, so.
And if the board accepted, so the public hearing is September 18th, when would the board act on the?
Not if we didn't hear any opposition that night, or if any new suggestions, we could do it that night, or we're gonna wait the following week. We're not, there's no hard deadline. Typically, we don't act on something the same night of the public hearing unless it's something that really has to. I mean, these are, like I said, this isn't an ordinance, it's strictly just a guideline for the board, so it's.
Even if it's horrible, and this is not a nice thing to say, but even if it's horrible, it's better than what they have now, which is nothing. So it's certainly a step, you know, if you're gonna allow development on a Class 6 road, it's a step in the right direction.
Like I said, we have said yes and we've said no. When I said we've attacked, I said yes and they've said no, is my understanding over the years. But they've never had any kind of written guideline. I mean, most of it's a case by case, and it still would be a case by case basis, but.
Yep. But at least you knew if you were 900 feet down the road.
Right, okay, yeah, you could say, okay, just because I know you, I'm gonna let you do it 900 feet, but, okay, I don't like you over here, I'm not gonna let you do it 100 feet in.
Yeah.
That could happen. Mm. It shouldn't happen, but unless you have some kind of policy. I don't know how you stop that. So.
Was there any other business to come before the board? Sorry, hand up on the back.
No, scratch on his head.
Mr. I can't think of Jeff's last name, from Bullen.
Mm-hmm.
Apps.
Jeff
Apps. Yeah, Apps. He's coming back next month, is that what he was planning on doing?
Yep.
Okay.
For what, Sarah, or for what?
The site plan.
Site plan approval, yeah.
And did you get a copy of his?
Yeah, it was submitted, yeah.
The notes, did you get the minutes, so you can see the notes? He wants to,
The only thing with the minutes and specifics is that he hasn't really submitted a proposal. That was just a discussion.
Who's he working with for engineer?
A woman who I don't know.
But he referenced that he wants to put in
19
one-bedroom apartments. Right. Were there density issues there? I mean, what are we? Are 19 units even allowed in that?
But he hasn't submitted an application.
That's true. But that's what he was hoping to do. So.
But that was he hadn't even finalized plans with it.
Okay.
He has known the water and sewer folks, and they said there weren't any issues.
No issue.
That's what he said. I don't have seen anything right. But
he does know the timeline though.
Okay. Wait for next one.
So October's gonna be a busy agenda.
I think so. Oh, and come on. I have a note, I think that's your question. On the select board. My notes. About training. Where is it? Find the right name. So you had talked about doing a training for the,
yep.
for the board anyways. I think the select board was hoping that was going to happen.
Okay.
If we could actually make that happen. I don't know why we thought.
We talked about doing it in August.
Yeah.
But there's
right.
two issues. One is that I wasn't here in August. The second issue is I don't know who your town attorney is. Because I did reach out to John Radigan, and he said he would gladly do it, but then he said, I'm not sure if I'm even the planning board's attorney anymore. So I guess it wouldn't be asked, it would be right to ask him to do it.
Well, our town attorney is Steve Roberts, but if the planning board could still hire.
Well, he said he would do it for free, but he didn't know right. if he was. He's done some work for the planning board, but limited. I mean, I don't
okay.
think he's done more than. I don't think he even billed an hour last year. But I don't, so I can ask him if he's
okay.
willing to do it. It's not, it sounds like it's not going to be in October now.
Yeah,
so.
We were sort of waiting for a late month.
And I just think this month would have been.
This month would have been.
But let me reach out to him and see
okay.
if he's willing to do that.
Great. Okay, in that case, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? All right.